When you do economic research, you have three pieces. I call, think of them as balls that I want floating up all the time. I'm juggling them. And one of them is the idea. I have to begin with, what's the question? What's important?
Economists, not a group with a lot of Marys, Natashas, or Juanitas. And that's caused a lot of controversy. However, what's often overlooked are the actual female economists who are pushing economics forward by addressing real-world issues. Welcome to Women in Economics.
One thing I definitely learned from Claudia is to approach economic research like a detective. I think especially when you're working in economic history, when you can't just download a cleaned up data set, you really have to go searching, open dusty boxes, and look under rocks.
She is the consummate economic historian. She has been the innovator and pioneer on bringing economic logic and historical and better data to understanding women's role in the economy. And then she is a fantastic labor economist who has been a leader in work on understanding inequality.
Claudia Dale Goldin was born in 1946 in the Bronx. She was a problem solver from the beginning. As a child, she avoided the New York City heat by spending her summer days playing cards or reading in air-conditioned department stores. And while she always knew she wanted to be a scientist of some kind, she wasn't always set on economics.
She'll tell stories to me about when she first went to the Natural History Museum when she was living in the Bronx and fell in love with mummies and thought that archaeology was going to be her passion. But then she discovered microbiology and she suddenly realized that microscopes uncovered a whole new world of discovery for her. And so it wasn't until she actually went to college at Cornell that she first got introduced to economics.
I decided to become an economist because I took an economics class from an amazing person named Fred Kahn. He was so excited about the field of industrial organization and product markets and regulation that it was infectious. And in fact, when I went to graduate school at the University of Chicago, I went there to study industrial organization.
Under the mentorship of Bob Fogel, Claudia studied American economic history, particularly the economics of slavery in the post-Civil War South. She had to travel to some southern states to gather archival materials for this research. Goldin didn't approach this trip like a traditional economist.
She thought, what I should do is hitchhike between the different cities in the South. She met someone in one of the archives who let her stay at their place. And when she came back, advisor asked her for a list of the receipts and expenses associated with the trip. And she had no clue that you were supposed to actually stay in hotels and pay for actual travel and that you could get reimbursed for this. But in fact, you know, by actually staying with the archivist and getting access to archives and knowledge that you wouldn't have had, it probably created inroads and understanding that wouldn't have been possible if you were going through usual channels.
She continued to focus on economic history, exploring such questions as why the North and South had such different economic outcomes after the Civil War.
And then I remember thinking that there were interesting aspects in terms of child labor and families. And it suddenly occurred to me the main changes in the labor force had to do with women.
She realized that there was a huge story in U.S. history that was missing from economist scrutiny, and that was the great evolution of women's labor force participation.
The women who were working for much of the history that I was looking at were young, single women. But then it morphed into studying how it was that older, married women with families joined the workforce.
Goldin combined deep archival research, history, and economics to conduct study after study, examining how various dimensions of women's participation in the U.S. labor force evolved over 200 years.
Claudia's best known for her contributions to the economics of gender. She sort of pioneers that area.
She has been thinking about, you know, things no one had known, like why is it that women's jobs were much more likely to be paid piece rate and men's jobs? Why is money taken away and given to their parents? The important role for caring for the family and how that affects the labor market. She just has a determination to figure out what's true, to find the new data, to read the historical sources, to think about what the actual people making decisions. You know, one of the huge advantages we have as economists, we can actually read the diaries of actual people making these decisions and talk to them and interview them when we're doing contemporaneous work or read their inner thoughts.
As just one example, Goldin's exhaustive research has led her to identify four phases going back to the late 19th century that shaped women's role in the U.S. economy. The first three phases were evolutionary. While important advances were made through the evolutionary phases, women also had limited control over key decisions affecting their employment. Women in those periods were more likely to view their working lives as intermittent and a means to put food on the table. Then came the Quiet Revolution, starting in the late 1970s. Women of the Quiet Revolution generally viewed their careers as a significant part of their personal identity and made their own decisions about their working lives. Goldin found that this latest phase was triggered mainly by increased investments in education and increased availability of contraceptives.
More than any other person, she has been central in the study of women and work in economics. She gave it a broad historical sweep. She tied it to economic theory in a tight way. Anyone who works on the issue of women and work going forward will be citing Claudia Goldin and will be influenced by her.
Working together with Larry Katz, she has also done critical research about education, technology, and the extreme dangers of income inequality.
She's among the first to document what we now think of as a U-shape of inequality over the 20th century. To this day, economists are still trying to figure out the determinants of that U-shape.
As the first woman to be offered tenure in the Harvard Economics Department, she also takes her role of mentoring the next generation of economists seriously.
As any graduate student will tell you, advisors play a critical role. It's these personal touches that make Claudia Goldin such a wonderful advisor. Whether it's walking her dog, Pika, with her, receiving midnight texts from her that always make me laugh.
She's not always serious, which of course is, I think, very important because if someone's constantly serious, it's just so intimidating as a student.
In 2014, Goldin started the Undergraduate Women in Economics program, a broad initiative to encourage more female economics majors.
When I'm doing my best research, I am reminded of what I learned from Claudia and how research can be fun, how it's a mystery that you want to unravel.
She brings a joy to her research. You know, we were famously called the dismal science. Well, certainly when Claudia Goldin does it, economics is anything but dismal.
Want to better understand Goldin and her contributions to labor economics? Click here for related materials and practice questions. Or check out other videos on how economists are tackling all sorts of issues, ranging from weighty topics such as the Great Recession and public health to everyday topics like wine. Yes, even wine.